Welcome to the 40th and last lecture of combinatorics. So, in the last class, we were discussing Stirling numbers of the second kind. We started by defining the Stirling numbers of the second kind in a combinatorial way. So, for instance, the numbers S, P, K was defined as the number of ways that we can partition the set 1, 2, 3 up to P into K subsets of this, right. We have to get a partition of 1, 2, 3 up to P into K non-empty subsets. In how many ways we can do that? That was SPK by definition. Now, we introduced the concept of different sequences, we studied what is difference table, and we understood that there is a special significance, there is some special significance for the numbers which appear in the difference table along the zeroth diagonal, because these numbers can be used, right. For instance, if the general term of the sequence is representable using a polynomial in n of degree p, then these numbers will be possibly non-zero till p, and p-through, I mean the first elements only we are taking from each row, they will become 0, p plus 1 through onwards. And then these p numbers, we can use as coefficients in representing that polynomial in using the basis where the members of the basis are n choose, so 0, n choose 1, up to n choose p, right. Then we also saw that we can use instead of n choose p, so this n choose n falling factorial p, right, n falling factorial 0, which is 1, n falling factorial 1, n falling factorial 2, n falling factorial p, and then the coefficients change. For instance, here the coefficients will be that C, P, I was trying to represent the specific polynomial n to the power P, right. Then we wrote the coefficient C 0 as C P 0 to indicate that we are actually talking about representing n to the power P, right. So, then this will become 0 factorial here. Plus here we will have C P 1 by 1 factorial, and in general for n k falling factorial we will have the coefficient of C P k by k falling factorial, and so on, right. So, and we told these numbers S P k, so these numbers C P k by k factorial actually are equal to S of p comma k. We haven't proved it, but we claim that this is right. So, we are going to verify that claim now. First, we will show that this number C p k, let's for the time being let's call it S dash of p comma k. This numbers S dash of p comma k satisfies the following recurrence relation for k 1 to p minus 1. This is equal to k into S of p minus 1 k plus S of p minus 1. Sorry. So, you will write S dash here for the time being, S dash of p minus 1 k minus 1, which is the same recurrence relation with the Stirling numbers of the second kind was holding. So, when we defined it using the combinatorial interpretation, right. we just have to verify that the initial conditions are also correct, namely s dash of 0 comma say so s dash of p comma 0, right, is equal to 1 if p equal to 0, that means s 0 0 is 1, or otherwise it is 0, p equal to 0. So is this correct? For instance, this is what s dash of p comma 0 is c p 0 by 0 factorial, which is, you know, if p was equal to 0, we are trying to represent n raised to 0, and we just have one term, this is 1, right. So this has to be 1 as usual, because cp 0 has to be, c 0 0 has to be 1. So we can say that s dash of 0 0 is 1. So let us assume that p is greater than 0, right. If p is greater than 0, what will happen? If p is greater than 0, then we know that this term has to be 0, because n raised to p does not have any constant term, right. P is greater than 1, greater than 0. So there is no constant term. So if you write this as cp 0, cp of 0 by 0 factorial into n raised to 0 plus cp of 1 by 1 factorial into, sorry, so n raised to 0, n raised to 1 following factorial and so on, then we know that all these later terms have n in it. So the only constant term is coming from here. So therefore, this, because there is no constant term, you know, on the LHS, so this has to be 0, cp 0 by 0 factorial has to. So that means s dash of p comma 0 will be 0 if p is greater than 0. This is what we get, right. So that was the same initial condition we had for the Stirling numbers of the second kind, right. Now also we have to worry about s dash of p comma p, right. We know that in the Stirling numbers of the second kind, when we considered p comma s dash s of p comma p, that was equal to 1, because we were considering the number of ways to partition the set 1 to p into p non-empty subsets, in, because it has to be non-empty, everything has to go into a different subsets, because yeah, so actually that has to be singleton subsets, that is only one way, right. So therefore yeah, so which essentially meant that this was equal to 1. Then how do I know that s dash of p comma p is equal to 1? So when you write n to the power p equal to c of p comma 0 by 0 factorial into n 0 following factorial, and final term being c p comma p by p factorial into n comma p following factorial. See, all the previous terms up to here has only powers of n to the power p minus 1 up to p n raised to power. The last term will have n p minus 1 following factorial, which has maximum n to the power p minus 1 as power. So the, if at all we have an n to the power p, that should come from here. And the, because you can see this is n into n minus 1 into up to n minus p plus 1. So n to the power p comes from this. So that is, the coefficient has to be this, right. But the coefficient for n to the power p is actually 1 from the LHS. So s dash of p comma p is equal to c p p by p factorial, by p factorial is equal to 1 by comparing the coefficients on both sides here, right. This is, this coefficient is the same as this coefficient, right, because that is the only place we have get coefficients for n to the power p, right. So because n to the power p minus 1 following factorial or n to the power p minus 2 following factorial, none of them will contribute to the coefficient of n to the power p, only n to the power p following factorial can contribute, and that contribution is exactly this, because if you look at this thing, there is no other, n to the power p comes in this thing with 1 as coefficient, so this will multiply that, right. So, both the initial conditions are same for the S dash and S, right. So, therefore, we just have to verify the recurrence relation, namely whether this S dash satisfies this recurrence relation, which is satisfied by the Stirling numbers of the second kite. If it satisfies, we are done. So, how do I verify that, right. Now, let us start from the this thing. So, we know that this is the way we define S p k. So, this is what sigma k equal to 0 to p s p k n to the power k following factorial. This is the way we define our n to the power p. And for reference, let us remember that I will write it here, n to the power p minus 1 can be written as sigma k equal to 0 to p minus 1 s of p minus 1 comma k into n k following factorial, right. Now, if I want to construct n to the power p, which is n into n to the power p minus 1. So, I can multiply this right with n. So, this means n into sigma k equal to 0 to p minus 1 s of p minus 1 comma k into n k following factorial. This is what we get. Now, see this n can go inside. So, n can go and join here, right, n can go and join here. So, it will look like this now, sigma k equal to 0 to p minus 1 into s of p minus 1 comma k into n k following factorial. So, now I can also rewrite this n as n minus k plus k for the purpose of splitting. So, we will write like this, n minus k plus k, right. So, this will look like n minus k plus k into this thing. Now, we can split it into, so we can multiply with this into this plus multiply by this into this, right. So, this will look like sigma k equal to 0 to p minus 1. S p minus 1 k n minus k into n k following factorial plus sigma k equal to 0 to p minus 1 s p minus 1 k, right. K into n k following factorial, right. So, this n minus k and k was actually n there, n minus k plus k. So, we just separated into two different terms. Now, what we can notice is these two things can be combined, because n, what is n k following factorial, this is n into n minus 1 into up to n minus k plus 1, k terms downward, right. Now, if I multiply by n minus k here, so here also I can put an n minus k. Notice that this n minus k is the next number below n minus k plus 1. So, it is as good as saying that this thing is equal to n k plus 1 following factorial. We are going starting from n, we are going down by 1 each, n minus 1, n minus 2, like that. K plus 1 terms now. Earlier it was only k terms when we considered n k following factorial. So by multiplying by n minus k, we are going down k plus 1 steps downwards. So it is n minus k plus 1 following factorial, right. So now we will use that. So we will rewrite this as sigma k equal to 0 to p minus 1 s p minus 1 comma k into n k plus 1 following factorial plus k equal to, see, we can just start from k equal to 1 to p minus 1 here, because when k equal to 0, this entire thing will go away, because 0 into something is 0. So we can start with k equal to 1 to p minus 1, that is s of p minus 1 k into k and k following factor. Now what is this? You can effect a, you can do a change of variable here. This k plus 1 can be now called k, right? Or maybe you can use a different variable if you want. So we do not have to, we just rename k plus 1 as k. That means now k will go from 1 to p, because when k is equal to 0, k plus 1 will be 1, right? K plus 1 will be 1, right? So p, when k is p minus 1, k plus 1 will be p. So that is why it is going from k equal to 1 to p, and this is s p minus 1. And when because now our k is k plus 1, so now this should be called k minus 1, right? Because we have changed the meaning of the variable. So here it will be nk, right? Plus this is okay, k equal to 1 to p minus 1 s of p minus 1 comma k, k into nk following factor. Sorry, this is k following factor. Now, what do we see here? We see that, so here this is going from k to p minus 1, this is k going from k equal to 1 to p minus 1 here, here also k equal to 1 to p. So we can separate one term here, so namely the pth k equal to p case, s equal to, that will look like s p minus 1 comma p minus 1 when k equal to p, this will be p minus 1 n p following factorial plus sigma k equal to 1 to p minus 1. We can combine the both the things together, right, this and this together, because I just removed the last term from this first this part, right. So now that is s p minus 1 k minus 1 plus k into s plus s p minus 1 k into s p minus 1 comma k into n k following factorial. This is what we get, this is this two, right, we collected together. Now this is our n to the power p, but we know n to the power p is actually sigma k equal to 0 to p s p k n k following factorial. Now we can compare the coefficients of n to the power k following factorial from both sides, right, from LHS and RHS. So for instance, when k equal to 0, this SPK is going to be 0, it is not going to have any, so we have already seen that SP0 is equal to 0, so it is k equal to 0 is not coming here at all, so that is okay, fine. When k equal to p, here it will be SPP, right, will be the coefficient of n p following factorial, here it will be SP minus 1 SP minus 1. We know both are 1, so there is that they are equal. So we are only interested in the case when k is in between 1 and p minus 1. In both these cases, we comparing the coefficients, we get on the LHS we get SPK on the RHS we get S P minus 1 comma K minus 1 plus K into S P minus 1 comma K. This is what we get, and this is exactly the relation that we had for the Stirling numbers of the second kind. Since the initial values are also same, we infer that these numbers, I should have put S dash here, right? I forgot to put S dash, I guess, right? I should have used S dash, but okay, fine, it's not a problem. So you have to assume that there was an S dash everywhere. So yeah, so it follows that this, because this S dash satisfies this condition as the earlier S, yes, we have, these are the Stirling numbers of the second kind, right? So okay, fine. Now before moving further, we will just mention that there is something called so we will notice that since this SPK is there is a combinatorial interpretation for this SPK, namely the number of ways we can partition the set 1 to p into k different k subsets, partition it into k subsets where each subset is non-empty, right? Or how we can put p different things into k boxes where the boxes are indistinguishable, right, such that no box is empty. That is what we interpreted. Now we also know that from the previous discussion, we also know that this SPK is equal to CPK by k factorial, where the CPK is the coefficient appearing in this when we try to express NPK like k equal to 0 to p. Right, k factorial into n k following factorial. When we want to represent n raised to p using n raised to k following factorials, this is the coefficient which is appearing for n k following factorial, right? C p k by k factorial. Now that is S p k. Then, because this has a combinatorial interpretation, the CPK also should have a combinatorial interpretation. Can we explain that? So, what give a combinatorial interpretation for CPK? Well, the CPK is actually k factorial into SPK. This thing is therefore, so you know, we have the set 1 to p and we are distributing it into k indistinguishable balls, boxes, such that none of the k boxes are empty, right? So k boxes we are taking, there are k of them here, we are putting the speed things into this, how many ways you can put, the condition is that no box is empty here. Now think of giving a label to each box. That means maybe we can apply a sticker on each box. This is the first box, this is the second box, this is the third box, and this is the kth box. Now you know, so it is now depending on the state. So for one arrangement corresponding to the indistinguishable boxes, now the stickers can be given in k factorial ways. Each will be considered a different arrangement because now the boxes are distinguishable, right? So therefore, this CPK is the number of ways to assign this 1, 2 up to p to k distinguishable boxes, k distinct boxes, right? K distinct boxes, k labeled boxes. That is what we see, because that is k factorial into SPK. Not that this assumption that SPK counts the cases where P things are distributed to K boxes where none of the boxes empty is very important. Otherwise, some labelings, for instance, suppose this and this was empty. So, when I label it 3 and this is 4, or when I label it this is 4 and this is 3. So, this different kind of labelings. So, one labeling I suggested is 3, 4 using black here. So, or 4, 3. Both would have looked same because the other things being same, here both are empty. How can, I mean, whether fourth box, this box and this both boxes empty, then it won't, whether I call it 3, 4 or 4, 3 will not, would not have made any difference, because anyway, in both cases, third box is empty, fourth box is also empty. But even if there is one thing here, the things are different, because the objects, this one to be the which thing here already makes this box, gives this box an identity. For instance, if I put A and B here and C and D here, and if I place 3 on this and 4 on this as the numbers, stickers, if I paste, so then that is very, that's definitely different from calling it 4 and 3, because now the fourth box contains AB, earlier the third box contained AB, right. So, that is why the non-empty condition is very important in say, because in this argument that now when you multiply by k factorial, we actually get the number of ways to assign P distinguishable, so P things, P different things to k boxes such that none of the boxes are empty. So, k distinct boxes such that none of the boxes are empty, that is very important. None of the boxes are empty is very important. It is if some boxes are empty, we cannot tell this thing, because then we have to say, we can only say that so many things are empty, then by say for instance h things are empty, we have to divide by h factorial, right. So, that won't make it equal to CPK. So, this CPK is that, but you can also remember that this number we are very familiar with. For instance, this putting, so if I write 1, 2, 3 up to P here, and this boxes, this label boxes, say the 1, 2, 3 K, these are the label boxes, say box 1, 2, 3 K, if I put here, and this assignment is a function, right, 1 goes somewhere, 2 goes somewhere else, 3 goes somewhere else, right. So, this is perfectly a function, it is a function, and not only a function, it is an onto function. So, this is a function from A to B, say A being this, and so A being P and B being K, right. So, A to B, there is a function, and it is an onto function because no box is now empty, because every number on the B side, everything on the B side should get a pre-image, right, that is what it says, right. Otherwise, empty boxes are not allowed. So, we are actually the same as counting the number of onto functions from the set P to this to this, right. And we know this number, how much is that? This is k to the power P minus k choose 1 to the power k minus 1 to the power P plus k choose 2 into P minus 2 to the power P n. So k minus 2 to the power P and so on. This we have done in two different ways. One was by considering the inclusion exclusion principle, because there are total of k to the power P functions onto or not, counting everything, right. Then we minus those functions which are skipping just one element, which are not giving a pre-image to exactly one element. A given one element, right. So, that is not exactly, some fixed element. So, that can be, that element can be selected in k choose one ways. So, and the number of functions which are mapping P things to the remaining k minus 1 things is k minus 1 raised to P. So, that is what this thing, but then we have overcounted, because there can be two things, say A and B, which are not getting pre-image at the same time. So, we just re-add it, k choose 2 into k minus 2 raised to p comes for that, and so on, right? This formula you can just go back and see from where we have studied. We had also done it using exponential generating functions, if you remember. So we had done it two times. So therefore, spk will be 1 by k factorial of that number, namely t equal to 0 to k minus 1 raised to t, k choose t into k minus t raised to p. This is the count of the without this 1 by k factorial. The rest is the count of number of onto functions from p things to k things. So, p 1 to p to 1 to k, right. So, right. So, we do not rederive this formula. So, and therefore, this number of onto functions from 1 to p to 1 to k is actually equal to CPK. So, if you are thinking that it is surprising, so it is advisable to look at, write down the sequence, say for n to the power p. So, what is the sequence corresponding to that? When I put n equal to 0, it will look 0. This is 1 to the power p. So, maybe I can put a little gap, 1 to the power p, then 2 to the power p, then 3 to the power p, and then 4 to the power p, then 5 to the power p. So, this is the sequence corresponding to n to the power p, right. So, now if I consider the first order difference sequence, this will be 1 raised to p minus 0, right. This is 1 to the power p. So this is the gap here, right, the corresponding to. So, here 2 to the power p minus 1 to the power p. Here it is 3 to the power p minus 2 to the power p, and here it is 4 to the power p minus 3 to the power p, and here it is 5 to the power p minus 4 to the power p, right, like that. So, now if I look for the second order difference sequence, so you can see that this number already CP0 is already the number of functions from p to the empty set, right, onto function, number of onto function. There is no onto function from p to empty set, right, that is not even a function. So, therefore, that is 0. And similarly, this number is already, this is the second number, this is CP1. This is the number of onto functions from p to say 1, right. There is only one function, that is 1 to the power p, because everything has to map to this 1, right. And now, let us look at CP2. CP2 will be obtained here in this gap, that is 2 raised to p minus 1, minus 1, one more minus, right. So, 2 raised to p minus 2, which is exactly the number of onto functions from p to 2, right. So, because there are total 2 to the power p functions, and then you can select one of the two things, and see, we can decide to map everything to the other. So, in two ways we can select that, and then there is just one function each. This is what, right, if you remember the way we counted the number of onto functions, this is exactly that, right. So, 2 to the power p, and this number for instance is 3 to the power p minus 2 into 2 to the power p plus 1 to the power p, right. Now, if you minus this from this, what do you get? 3 to the power p minus 3 into 2 to the power p. Plus 3, right. Is it plus 3? Yeah. So is it the same as, so 3 to the power p minus 3 into 2 to the power p, and this plus 3. Yeah, because total number of functions now, so from p to 3 we want to consider onto functions, right. So, this is 3 to the power p total. Now, one can be avoided, let us just fix one of the elements and avoid that. So, that is 3 choose 1 ways we can fix it, and 2 to the power p functions. Now, avoid two things together, that is 3 choose 2 is equal to 3 ways you can do that, right. So, and then there is just one function to map everything to the remaining. So, this is the number. So, like that. So, it is not very surprising. So, if you carefully look at, this is indeed the number of onto functions along this 0th diagonal, we will see the number of onto functions from P to K, right. So, now we will look at the Stirling numbers of the first kind. Stirling numbers of the first kind. The Stirling numbers of the first kind, we will use small s, small letter s to denote it, s of p comma k. For the Stirling numbers of second kind, we had used the capital S. That by definition counts the number of arrangements of p objects into k non-empty circular permutations. What does it mean? So, we have s p k. We will say that, so we have this 1, 2, 3 up to p, and these things, these p things, we have to arrange into k non-empty circular permutations. For instance, we can take say 1, 2, 3, say and say 4, 5 up to p, right. This 1, 2, 3 we can arrange in a circular way like this, right. And the remaining 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 up to p we may arrange in this way. But then there are several ways of arranging, see 1, 2, 3. So, we can also have 1, 3, 2. This is a different arrangement. Remember, it is a circular way means, see if I rotate in counter clockwise direction, it is not going to make any change. For instance, we will say, you remember the way we defined the equivalence of the circular permutations, in the sense that if I always, for instance, if I look at the clockwise direction, if I always see the same person, same number, then from every number, then it is the same thing. The way right is unimportant. For instance, if I write 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and if I just write 5, 1, 2, 3, 4. This is the same because we have just rotated it like this, because any number if you look, its clockwise neighbor is the same. Similarly, if you look at the counterclockwise neighbor, that is going to be the same, right. Then we say that it is the same circular permutation. So, but on the other hand, if this number, if you had written the reverse, for instance 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, this is different. This is different because, you know, the counterclockwise neighbor and clockwise neighbors are different in this arrangement and this arrangement. For say, if you consider 1, here 2 is a clockwise neighbor, 5 is a counterclockwise neighbor, anti-clockwise neighbor. Here it is 5 is the clockwise neighbor and 2 is the, so they have reversed the role. So, therefore, that is a different arrangement. So, how many circular permutations are there? We had discussed it in one of the earlier and in the beginning classes. When we studied the circular permutations, right, the division principle. So, when we studied that, we had discussed this thing. So, we know that if there are n things, there are n minus 1 factorial ways to circularly permute them, right. So, the first question we can ask is, what is Sn1 or Sp1, say Sp1, say. That means, if I want to arrange p things, 1, 2, 3 up to p, into just one circular permutation, then there are p minus 1 factorial ways to do it, because we are only allowed to use one circle and all of this p elements has to appear in that circle, and then we have to circularly permute it. We know that it is p minus 1 factorial. But on the other hand, what will be s p comma p? Sorry, not this is, I have to use small s, s p comma p. What is s p comma p? S p comma p is the same as S P comma P. Why? Because you know, to make one observation we can easily make is, suppose if I want to say, if I write, if I am looking for S P comma K, so the P things are there, 1 to P, they have to form K different circles which are all non-empty, right? So, but for that, first we have to decide which goes to, we have to first divide the P things into K subsets. Then each subset has to be arranged in a circular way. The first step corresponds to the Stirling number of the second kind, right? So, for each partitioning of 1 to P into K subsets, such that each subset is non-empty, that count is SPK, right? The Stirling number of the second kind, right? We for each such subset we can arrange the members of the subset in circular permutations in various ways. For instance, if there were in a particular circle, if there are I things, we can arrange it in I minus 1 factorial ways, each of them, right? So, typically we will expect that this small s of p comma k will be much bigger than capital S of p comma k, but this is in any way correct for all p k greater than 0 by the from the combinatorial interpretation, because first of all we have to partition p into k subsets which are all non-empty. Then for each such partition, we can generate lots of circular permutation for each such part in the partition, right? But there are some cases which where this small s of p comma k, that is the Stirling number of first kind, is equal to the corresponding Stirling number of the second kind. When is that? For instance, when k equal to p, that means when we are talking of s of p comma p. S of p comma p means we see, first we have to divide into p subsets. So, the p things only are there, but each subset has to be a singleton then, right? There is no other way. So, each one becomes a singleton set, right? If each one becomes a singleton set, then the singleton sets does not have many circular permutation among themselves, right? Because it is a one element thing, and what can happen to that? It is only one, right? So, therefore, that is that partitioning into subsets itself will correspond to the ways we can circularly permute into k p different circles. So, this is one such case where we do not get more. So, this S p p is equal to S of p p, which is equal to 1 anyway, there is only one way of doing it. And another case which this where this happens is S p, so when I consider small s of p comma p minus 1, right? Then what happens is we have to first partition p things into p minus 1 groups. So, except one among them, all others has to be singleton this time, right? Because we have to get p minus 1 things, only one of them has a chance to become, one of them has to become a two element subset. No, all others has to become singleton sets, right? There may be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 6, 7, something like that. So, but which two stood together, that decides the entire partition, and that can be decided in p choose two ways. Any two can be selected first and then make them a two element subset, and all others are singleton sets. This is the way you can partition. And now we say that each of them can, we have to allow circular permutations of them, but then here singletons cannot circularly permute in more than one way, because there is only one element there, what circular permutation is possible. That is other than just that. And even for two elements it is true, because we do not have more opportunities, because we just have this. See, if this is 1 and 2, we have this circular permutation. If you write 2 and 1, it is the same thing, right? So, therefore, here also we do not have any difference between Stirling number of the first and second kind when they correspond to p comma p minus 1 as parameters, right? So, this is also S of p comma p minus 1, which is p minus p choose 2, right? These are two cases where but then there are situations where it can be different. For instance, S42. So we can look at S42. In S42, first let us say we will two parts should come, right. So we can put a singleton set and a 3-element set. So what is the way? So we will take one first. So we will first partition it one, and then so this is the basics. So 1, 2, 3, 4. So I will take 1 and 2, 3, 4, right. Now here see, if it is for just for partition, this can be done, or it can be say 2, 1, 3, 4, and 3, this can be written as 1, 2, 4, and this can be 4, 1, 2, 3. There are 4 ways of putting into 2 subsets. So this all counts for Stirling number of the second kind, and also we have 2 and 2 partitions, right. So this is 2 things can go on one side, and that is the only way we can do either 3 things, 1 things, 1 singleton set and 3 element set. Other way is just 2 element set and 2 elements. So that can be done in 3 ways, right, 1, 2, 3, 4, or it can be 1, 3, 2, 4, or it can be 1, 4, 3, 2, right. Because you know the other way, for instance 3, 4, 1, 2, we need not count because that is the same thing as 1, 2, 3, 4. This will correspond to the Stirling number. But then here these things does not contribute more. So when I am counting a Stirling number of the second count, when we look for the Stirling number of the second kind, we will only be looking for how many this partitions only I will be counting. But then in the case of Stirling number of the first kind, we have to consider each of them and then see how many ways I can circularly permit them. That is 1, 2, 2, 3, this we do not get anything more, because 1, 2 cannot be circularly permitted in more permuted in more than one ways, because there are only 2 elements here similarly. So all these things give only just 1 each, but here we can give more. For instance, if I take this, right, this 1 does not give me any scope, right, it will just be like that. But 2, 3, 4 can be done in 2 different ways. Either you can put it as 2, 3, 4 like this, this is one circular permutation, or it can be written as 2, 4, 3, this is different. So we know that it is 3, 4, 3, 2 factorial ways of permitting it. So starting from 2, next can be 3, or next can be 4, right, no other way. So these are the 2 ways. So we get from each of them, we get 2 each. So we get 4 into 2, 8 circular permutations corresponding to each of these partitions, plus here 3. So 11 will be the answer for this S42. S42 equal to 11, while S capital S42 will be only 6, right. Yeah, capital S42 will only be 6. So yeah, for instance, we had a formula for finding capital S42, namely CSP2 was equal to 2 to the power p minus 1 minus 2, right. So here if you put 4, so this is 4, this will be 8 minus 2 equal to 6. We had discussed this formula last time. We can, if you want to cross verify whether this is indeed 6 or not. So for capital S it is 6, but you see that small s it is 11, because some of those partitioning of the four elements, especially when we have split them into singleton and three element sets. So each such partition gives rise to more circular permutation, this thing, more arrangements, because you know three elements can be part circularly permuted in two different ways. That is why four of them gave 8 and then plus 3, right. That is why this leaf. So now the next thing we want to discuss is some this identity may be interesting. So k equal to k equal to 0 to n, not p, k 0 to n, yes, so we get k equal to 0 to n, this one, 0 to n, small s of n comma k. If you add up all these things, we will get n minus, sorry, we will get n factorial. Why is it so? Because if you take, you know, this is the number of permutations of 1 to n, the number of permutations of 1 to n. If you take any permutation, you have a cycle structure in it. For instance, you can consider 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, n. So, for instance, this is 3, 5, right, 3, 3, 5, 4, and 1, suppose something like this. So, suppose this kind of a permutation, say this 10. So, I see that 1 goes to 3, 3 goes to 5, 5 goes to 4, 5 goes to 4. So, 1 goes to 3, 3 goes to 5, 5 goes to 4, and 4 goes to 1, 4 goes to 1. We closed the cycle. So, then we start from somewhere else and we will create another cycle. So, this will permutation can be represented by a collection of cycles like that. If you write down the 1 to n up there, the values. So, how I write is I will always go to pi of I, where pi is the permutation, and then pi of I will go to pi of I, and so on, right. So, definitely it has to come back, and if you think for some time, you will see a cycle structure there, which we have not discussed it in detail before, but if you give some thought, you will realize that every permutation will give rise to a circular arrangement of 1 to n into some k, some number of cycles, right. So, suppose it is right, so of case now this can be depending on each permutation can be grouped into, so for instance, we can group the set of permutations into n groups, namely if the cycle corresponding to that permutation has 1 cycle or 2 cycle or 3 cycle or n cycle. Now, if you count one of the groups, then what will you see? You will see that we will be producing lot of circular arrangements into exactly say k cycles, if you consider the group where the number of cycles are k, and this exactly corresponds to S of n comma k, because conversely any circular arrangement of n into k exactly k circles will correspond to one of the permutations also. I leave it to you to figure out how this is happening. So, So therefore, if you sum up this smallest of n to k from k equal to 0 to n, we have to get the total number of permutations of n, namely n factorial, right. Now, the next thing I want to discuss is so this is a b is should be made to n. So, the next thing I want to discuss is, so there is a similar recurrence relation for SPK, namely when k is in between 1 and p minus 1, we can write SPK is equal to p minus 1 times s into p minus 1 comma k plus s in s of p minus 1 k minus. This is the same, almost the same as the recurrence relation for the Stirling number, just that here we have p minus 1, earlier it was k. In other words, for this, if you consider this particular term, in the Stirling number of second kind, we were multiplying with the lower index, but here we are multiplying by the upper index, right. And to remember this recurrence relation, we just have to remember that it's if you just discard this multiplication, it is the same as the recurrence relations for NCR. So now in the Stirling number of the second kind, we have to multiply by the lower index in the first term, SP minus 1 k, that term the lower end k should be the multiplier. In the other one, the higher index, namely p minus 1, should be the multiplier. The proof of this thing is more or less the same as the other one. We will consider a special element p. We will ask whether that appears as a singleton cycle or not. In that case, it can happen in SP minus 1 k minus 1 ways. On the other hand, if it is not coming as a singleton, then we remove that, and the remaining things can be arranged into k circular permutations, circles and each of circular permutations s p minus 1 into k ways. Now, this last element can be inserted into any of them in p minus 1 ways, because we can put it behind any, for instance, if you assign an order, say clockwise order or something, we can think of putting this thing behind any of the element. So, that will result in a circular arrangement of p things. So, this is a little fast because we do not have time, we are just introducing this thing, but you can figure it out yourself. And finally, we will say that corresponding to the formula. So, we told that when I wrote n to the power p as, so using n k following factorials, right, k equal to 0 to p, the coefficients were actually second Stirling numbers of the second kind. Now, on the other hand, if you write n p following factorial using n to the power k, right, so k equal to 0 to p, except for a negative sign, we get minus 1 p minus k here. So, the other thing is the Stirling number of the first kind. So, I will just show you there in the slide. This is the way it will come. So, this also you have, you can read from say the textbook by Richard Rualdi or maybe any book. So, this is the last thing, we end the course by this thing. So, thank you very much for listening to the course.